opening act, but it's time for the real band to begin. It's Frodan and Sottl here on the casting desk to bring you guys the last day of the summer preliminary for Americas. In fact, the last preliminary that at least our coverage team will be providing. It's my pleasure to open up with Sottl, who I am considering the bright star of 2016 in terms of our caster talent pool. How you doing, man?
Wow. I was not prepared.
Frodan
has been savagely burning me all weekend, and now finally we go live and he surprises me with glowing praise. Thank you so much, Frodan. I have drawn a lot of inspiration from you, so if I'm doing well, you should take credit for it yourself.
Fantastic. We're in this together, buddy.
Yep.
We're going to go into game number one with an all-Latin American upper bracket finals, which does mean that one of these players is guaranteed to go through. Another cool story for Latin America, constantly grabbing a piece of the pie.
Right.
They do also have their own tech and their own versions of decks, Sottl. Which are the ones that stand out to you the most?
Yeah, I mean, Pascoa's entire lineup is pretty interesting. Really quite departed from, you know, the Fab Four lineup, as we've started to call it. He has Yogdruid, which of course is one of those core decks, but outside of that, there's a Freeze Mage, a Control Shaman, and OTK Worgen. Now, that is a crazy looking lineup.
Yeah, it's one that has a lot of risks inherently built in it, because a lot of those decks do draw a little bit awkwardly sometimes. You have those combo warriors sometimes get the wrong end of their draws. You do have the Freeze Mage, which can be susceptible to only drawing your Frost Novas. And then, of course, the Control Shaman also has Yogg-Saron in it. That's a really crazy thing, because I want my late game to be very consistent all the time, too, to be able to do the same exact big wall of taunts, but he sometimes puts his faith in our Lord and Savior Yogg-Saron. So that's a really cool thing already, and we are going to see that being played. Interesting that Pascoa has made it this far without a Warrior deck. That's the number one thing that sticks out to me. Warrior has not only been brought by so many people, but it's also been banned.
Right.
And it feels like the reason why you bring the Warrior is purposely because you want to take away the options from your opponent to choose a better ban.
Yeah, absolutely. When you're going into a tournament, if most people will be devising deck strategies, saying, okay, this is my lineup and here's my ban order, and top of most people's ban order is Warrior. So if you are bringing a lineup with a Warrior deck in it, you're basically just playing directly into your opponent's strategy, because they're just going to remove that Warrior from you anyway. So Pascoa is going for something a little bit different here. Just quickly, Topo Pablo has a slightly more standard lineup with decks that you might be expecting, but there are some interesting twists in each of his decks. He's running Maelstrom Portal in his Shaman, for example, Arcane Explosion in his Mage, as well as Cabalist Tome. So he definitely has some of his own South American flavor thrown into his decks.
Certainly. So here we go. We're going to start things off with Druid versus Mage. Now, this Mage deck from Topo Pablo does have a couple of interesting cards, one of them being the Arcane Explosion, which is, I believe, an underrated card, but I still don't feel like even it's underrated is a card that I want to put in my deck. I don't mind picking it off of Ethereal Conjurer sometimes, or getting it off of Cabalist's Tome, which is also in Pablo's deck. But taking one of the 30 spots away and, for example, not playing Firelands Portal, I do have to wonder like what specifically he has in mind. What do you think is specifically the reasoning behind this choice here, Sottl?
I mean, there's so much spell damage in the deck now, especially when Topo Pablo is choosing to run the list that uses Blood Mage as well. So your chance for Arcane Explosion to essentially be a 2-mana Flame Strike is actually quite high based on the amount of spell damage that's in the deck. So that can be reasonably effective, but primarily you're looking at things like Token Druid and you're looking at things like Zoo when you're playing Arcane Explosion, because against Token Druid, it makes a big deal, this matchup that we're seeing right now, because it means your opponent has to immediately commit a Power of the Wild to any token board that they generate or risk losing all their value just to your 2-mana AoE.
Already some interesting choices coming here on turn number one of the game. Pascoa choosing not to play Living Roots to get onto the board, said Raven Idling, and then was deciding between a few cards, ended up going for a second Living Roots, which I do feel like it's the most flexible card.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with the decision to not play Roots onto the board here. Generally, the way I think you beat Tempo Mage, or the way Tempo Mage loses, is it doesn't get any of its minions to connect with face in the early game. From that point, it just really, really struggles, because they don't have the late game value to make a value push on the board. They need to kind of burn you down in the late game. So this hand of like Living Roots, Wrath, this can just easily snipe down the first few minions that come out and just put Druid in this position where their superior late game will dominate.
And Druid has been gravitating more towards that late game. You see them running two Ancients of War in Onyxia, sometimes Cenarius and Yogg-Saron. We've seen some of them throw Ragnaros into a mix, and that's a really good amount of cards that cost seven or more that allows you to have a lot of firepower, not to mention, of course, the potency of late game swings with Violet Teacher and Fandral Staghelm.
Yeah, and specifically picking up another Living Roots here, even though he had one in hand, like, often you take a flexibility pick there off the Raven Idol just to have something different in your hand. But this deck plays an enormous amount of 3-2s in the early game with the Cult Sorcerers and the Sorcerer's Apprentices, so Living Roots is a card that you pack four of in your deck quite comfortably against Tempo Mage.
Comfortable, it looks like Pascoa is, because he just picked up a very strong main to pair Innervate with. For a while, his hand looked very awkward, because he would be able to remove, but he eventually needs to get onto the board. And if you keep drawing removal, you eventually need to fight back and try to win. So if your Living Roots here, he has Wrath and Hero Power next turn to answer pretty much anything for 3 mana. And then on his 5 mana turn, he could play his Ancient of War. Very, very strong.
Yeah, I love this decision. A lot of people would have been tempted to use Wrath there just as the more expensive card in the hand and get it out of the way with Living Roots being more flexible. But you know, Wrath can cycle later on, which is important. But as you said as well, Wrath plus Hero Power can potentially snipe down a Flame Waker, which was the minion that would be played on curve here if Mage wanted to do that.
Now, interestingly enough, because Topo Pablo chose to take a more slow approach to drawing cards, Pascoa's turn is also invalidated.
Yeah.
You know, usually it is called a Tempo Mage, although that is more of a community colloquial term for the deck, because usually tempo implies that you want to play as fast as you can onto the board. In this case, it's more of a dynamic deck. I usually just call it a mid-range deck, because it feels like that's how you adapt the strategy accordingly.
Right. Just Flame Waker Mage, Missile Mage, any of these things seem appropriate.
Tilt Mage.
Tilt Mage, yeah, why not? But yeah, Topo is playing the slower version of the deck, the deck that TJ and I were quite derisive towards in the opening game of yesterday. Neither of us are huge fans of the Cabalist Tome build. We like to be more aggressive with the deck, but Topo Pablo playing more of the late game value cards might give him a better chance at going long against this Druid deck, which Pascoe's opening strategy is dictating is what he wants to do.
Wow.
But he is going to start running into Ancient of Wars very, very quickly, and he doesn't have super clean answers to them just yet.
You also have the opportunity to use the Druid the Claw this turn to take advantage of this Mana Worm that's relatively low in power, because if you play an Ancient of War, you do give the opportunity for Mana Worm to trade up if you play a certain amount of spells like Fireball and Arcane Blast, or Fireball, Arcane Missiles, or even Fireball and Mirror Image.
Yep. Yeah, I mean, I can definitely see that, but Druid of the Claw is quite often reserved for charging into Flame Waker in this matchup a lot of the time. He does have that Wrath in his hand, but if the Flame Waker, you know, if he's forced to use that Wrath beforehand, doesn't pick up a swipe, I can definitely see his need to hold on to that Druid of the Claw. And it also just kind of works a little bit better with his curve to go innovate 7 this turn and then 5 next turn and 7 again.
Sure. Also makes a lot of sense, too. Given that the fact that his opponent can also respond with such a high amount of cards in hand, you're just trying to drain their opponent of resources. You're not that optimistic about this first Ancient of War's chance to survive. It is the frontline Ancient of War, which you always expected. It's always the second coming of Ancient of War, his brother who's out for revenge.
Yeah, I mean, basically, if you're the Druid player in this position, you're like, okay, my mage opponent has a lot of cards, but he's probably going to have to, like, 3-for-1 himself into this Ancient of War. Then I'm probably going to pick up a 2-for-1 with the Druid of the Claw, and then the second Ancient of War can be backbreaking. I still have Wrath to cycle. I can still mulch any big threat that he plays. So even though you are a long way down on card advantage here, you're probably not feeling terrible in Pascoe's position.
Yeah, but when he starts seeing the Azure Drakes, that might change his opinion.
Right.
Azure Drakes are very powerful, especially with Arcane Blast. That card is pretty crazy.
Yeah, he's going to go ahead and choose to use the missiles here instead of the blast for that exact reason, and that's close to the perfect outcome. Of course, none of the hits to the Ancient were actually necessary. He just needed to buff the Mana Worm, so 3 to face would have been perfect, but he will take the 2.
Yeah, it was a pessimistic, you know, in case in case it misses, you know, if he attacks into the Ancient of War first and then tries the Arcane Vessels to guarantee damage there, it's like, in that case, he would be really bad.
Oh, so yeah, yeah, of course. You know. Yeah, definitely the correct ordering. It's just he could have had a slightly better outcome hitting the face if he had rolled a little bit higher, but I like his decision to use the missiles instead of the blast, since he has all this spell damage in hand to make the blast more useful moving forward, but not a great target here with the Drake Blast, but he can go ahead and use the Cult Sorcerer instead.
It's a pretty even game back and forth. Druid still has yet to pick up some of their great ability to swing the board through Violet Teachers and Phandral Staghelm. That's usually the way they build a huge board. Until then, Pascu is just left playing defense. And Topolpavo just has a lot of gas. I mean, he not even just the Azure Drakes, but also Flame Waker plus some of these cheaper spells is going to be really annoying to deal with. Pascua just picks up Innervate, which is not exactly the most useful card right now, but you still have the ability to use it with the Wrath and remove it with Ancient of War.
That's true. Ancient of War, Innervate, Wrath is definitely reasonable. He could also try and cycle the Wrath right now with Blood Mage and trust his deck to pick himself something up that he could play even with the Innervate. But yeah, having drawn the Innervate, the decision to just drop a 5/10 on the board this turn is important. It's just before the Innervate, I may have bypassed the 5/10 just purely for the fact that I just am such a huge fan of killing every minion that Mage plays in this matchup.
I'm trying to look at what cards Innervate would be important to keep with if he's holding on to it, because if you Blood Mage and Wrath Cycle, you're most likely going to pick up a card that you can't really play. So what would you want to pair with Innervate? But the value of it is with cards like Teacher, Phantom Stag.
Right. Well, so if you Blood Mage Wrath, you could use the Innervate to play a card that you drew, like a Drake or Emperor Thorasan, for example. So it would give you at least... Oh, no, Emperor would still be one off, right? Yeah. So you'd be looking for a 5-drop, but yeah. I'm not sure how I feel about holding onto this Innervate at this point. Like, he's just allowing the spell damage to take out one of the biggest threats in his deck.
Yeah, and not only just the biggest threats, but also the biggest resource drain, which really isn't as much anymore. Right now it's already absorbing at least 2 cards, but it could absorb even more.
And he hasn't seen a single Arcane Blast yet either, which means that the potential value of spell damage is so high. This is almost absolute worst-case scenario in terms of what could have happened to his 5/10. But from my perspective, he was playing this matchup so well to start off with, just completely shutting down Mage's ability to keep anything on the board, and then seemed to just deviate from that game plan for that one turn.
Yeah.
And you can see he's got punished for it just a little bit.
Yeah, I completely agree. I think it was one of those things where he's now allowed the Mage to get value, and as a result, a lot closer. That's a pretty good pickup, though.
Yeah.
Allowing him to clear the board and be able to cycle at least one of these Wraths. And also, who knows what this Raven Idol can pick up. It's 10% to pick up the card that you want exactly. I'm sure he's open to ideas at this point. Maybe Nourish would be really good because he would be low on card count.
Yeah, Nourish would definitely be a useful tool. Feral Rage is a reasonable consideration. He hasn't seen Drakes come down yet, and if he's keeping track of the minions that he's killed, he knows that there are a few of the only threats left in the deck. So Feral Rage is a decent card to be able to answer those one for one. I'm sure we're going to see the Innervate Wrath number 2 come out this turn to take out the Flame Waker, so no real concern as to trying to find a play for the near distant future, but definitely that Feral Rage is probably the most flexible card overall.
Yeah, actually, Azure Drake is the only minion that's... It's besides Yogg-Saron, it's the only minion that you have to worry about that has 4 health or higher in that case. So, actually Flame Waker. So it just tops out at Azure Drake, really.
Yeah.
Nothing really else to consider, so a Feral Rage definitely has that strength there.
There it is. There is my favorite card in all of the game, Dan.
I can't help but feel like you're being sarcastic, Subtle.
Where did you get that impression? I think this card has an incredible amount of potential. Potentially when we see a non-Reno control mage potentially come out of the later weeks of Karazhan with some of the cards that they're being offered.
Medivh's Valet.
Medivh's Valet, exactly. I think Cabalist Tome can do really well in that deck. I just don't understand 5-mana do nothing in a tempo deck.
It's not 5-mana do nothing. It's okay, what about Arcane Intellect? What do you think about Arcane Intellect and what its function is?
If I could cut that card from this deck, I would, but there is not enough tempo card draw in the game as basically Drake and that's it to an extent. Yeah. So it's kind of a necessary evil, but still most of the time you're trying to cast that for 2 in the deck, which is kind of barely allowable in terms of doing nothing to draw cards, but 5 is just unforgivable, and it's not even necessarily giving you good cards from your deck. It's giving you a random selection of spells.
Okay, let me ask you another question. Do you think the Babbling Book is a good card?
Yes. Not necessarily in Tempo Mage, though.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I do think the value of a random mage spell is a lot higher than people, actually for the average class. A lot of people probably do accurately depict it because people think mage spells are awesome, which they appropriately are.
Right.
I think the worst case scenarios are a couple of secrets that don't feel too situational, for example, Effigy, when you have like mirror images. But I do think on average, Cabal's Tome does give you a lot more gas. And if you're able to budget your resources accordingly, if you just have one in the deck, I think it adds you a reasonable amount of fuel, especially because you have Yogg-Saron and it is a charge to the Yogg-Saron. You have Flame Wakers, which most likely you can pair it with, or even Mana Worms. I don't think it's necessarily the worst choice. And I do think there are cards in the deck that do perform worse than Cabal's Tome, in my opinion. By the way, update on the bracket. Muzzy has defeated Dota 2 better. And is going to move on in the lower bracket, keeping the dream alive. Muzzy, of course, is the point leader in all of the American region. And that is a very good result for him. He's been looking for a good result for a while.
We made it an entire day without having to say the words Dota 2 better. And then finally, just at the last hurdle, we got caught out. But there is that interaction that I talked about, specifically the Feral Rage taking down the Azure Drake. And as you pointed out, the minion value left in this Tempo Mage deck is incredibly low now. There is this Azure Drake and then the second Flame Waker. Mana Worm just, you know, great on turn one, loses value quite significantly in the later turns.
There is also an aspect of Cabal's Tome, which it's very similar before Yogg-Saron like started becoming very common. It's like the theme of Cabal's Tome does give you an opportunity to open up potential paths that neither you or your opponent can plan for.
Yes.
And it does give an opportunity for you to have some interesting situations where the longevity of your deck is extended because of it.
I completely agree with that. Concealed information is incredibly powerful in this game, especially when it's in such a wide range. It's one of the things I like about Ivory Knight as well, is the potential to conceal information from your opponent, but also choose which information to reveal. Like, you can pick a card with a specific mana cost to, for example, bluff that you took Consecration or Equality or something like that.
Or even keep your opponent in the dark because you're at full health, so they're completely mystified. Or, you know, even worse is when your opponent's at 29, they heal for one, and you're like, well, is that because they took a one mana card or because they took an 8 mana card? And I can't really tell. But that's information nonetheless, which makes it really cool.
Yeah, but back in the game, Pascoa again with just excellent threat recognition here. Mulch, an incredibly high value removal, but he recognizes there are so few threats remaining. He just goes ahead, jams it on that Azure Drake, Living Roots with spell damage to take out the Mana Worm. And as I said, if Tempo Mage just can't stick minions to the board, it's so hard for them to push through in the late game.
There is one thing that allows Topo Pablo to potentially just swing back the game. And it is pretty viable, considering that Druid is also low on resources and Mage does have stall in his hand.
Yeah.
So it feels like the plan to wait until Yogg-Saron to do something or even end the game.
Yes.
Is probably what Topo Pablo's thinking. He's used both Azure Drakes. He has one Flame Waker remaining. He does have things like Sorcerer's Apprentice also remaining in the deck, but it's like you said, he needs to generate some damage besides the spells in his hand.
Yeah. It is a very real possibility that this is now just a Yogg game, and that Fandral is a big deal for Pascoa, because important to him, although he was doing a great job controlling the game in the early game, he wasn't really generating threats once his Ancient of Wars went down. But now, with the Fandral paired with the Power of the Wild, or the Azure Drake that he just picked up, he can now at least start to build himself a board presence.
It's got a lot of cycle. The Druid, of course, also has their fair share of spells mixed in with the Yogg-Saron. Druid the Claw, not necessarily bad either here. He is aware that his opponent has not played a single spell from Cabal's Tome.
Right.
And you're always worried about the worst case scenarios, Flame Strike being one of them, or it seems like Dragon's Breath is very common off of Cabal's Tome too. I get that quite a bit.
Not to mention there is just a natural copy of Flamestrike in the deck. Topo Pablo is choosing not to go down the Firelands portal route for this tournament, perhaps just didn't have enough time to test it to his own satisfaction, is instead sticking with that Flamestrike that might turn out to be a little bit old school, but for now the Flamestrike might actually be a key card to interact with some of these token plays that Pascal is going to generate in the coming turns.
What to do?
At what point does the plan to burn your opponent down with the damage spells that you have against the druid, does that become viable even if your opponent's at 19? You have two torches, I believe, that in your deck that now became boring torches. And you have an Ice Lance, which means that the moment you pick up Frostbolt, it converts into damage.
Yeah, it's very true. I mean, he doesn't need much. That's his one Cabalist Tome gone, though, is the problem. I think it'd be a little bit more valuable maybe if there was a second tome that he could try and pick up more damage from. But at that point, it's probably still not enough to quite get you there with the fact that Druid can match your hero power damage with his hero power damage over the course of each turn. So you might end up, if you go down that line, just relying on Yogg to push through a little bit of extra damage at the end of the game. And if you're relying on that strategy anyway, you might as well also rely on Yogg to do other work for you as well.
Speak of the devil, Yogg-Saron comes to the hand of Pascoa. I don't feel like he's in a position where he needs to play Yogg versus the mage. I would argue that the moment he gets Yogg, any time is appropriate.
Yeah. I would
even
agree.
Even if you played Astral Communion, you're not really losing much, right, which is a little bit ironic, considering the Topo Pablo also has another Arcane Explosion in the deck. So yeah. If he drew it, it'd be equally useless. Another thing to consider is that there is certain thresholds for Yogg-Saron that players tend to gravitate towards, because the higher amount of spells, the higher percentages to draw cards, for example, or to play Area of Effect board clears.
Yeah, early on, when people were trying to work out exactly how Yogg worked and what it meant for the game, you know, people thought there was like a sweet spot of spells that you were supposed to hit where it came out optimally. But I think as time goes on, people have just reached the point where more is more. Like, there is no upper limit of spells that you should cast before Yogg. It's just the more you cast, it's always better.
Yeah, I definitely like that philosophy. I also like this very scrappy piecing together of Flamestrike type plays. Like, he technically has an ability to clear the board.
He does. I mean, yeah, his three Cabalist Tome cards are coming together to actually do something here. So I guess you win this round, Dan.
Thank you.
Yeah. What to do?
Using Ice Lance to clear the Vandril. I definitely think Vandril is very threatening if your opponent picks up Nourish. I believe both Raven Idols were used, though. That is one of the more scarier things. When your opponent gets Raven Idol, picks a minion, and Raven Idol picks a minion and something else, and then all of a sudden they just got so much card resource.
He's looking to hold on to the Arcane Explosion here, which is interesting. I guess his concern is that he hasn't seen a Violet Teacher yet. So he does still have that natural copy in his deck, though. And this, apparently, for Pascoa, is going to be the Yogg turn. So this is a slightly unusual use of Yogg. He's just going to try and use his Yogg to generate some value for him. It's not a panic switch. He's just looking for stuff exactly like this. Card draw, board presence, death rattles, call
of
the
wild. Did you say board presence? Okay, well, Forbidden Flame not doing too much here.
Aww.
I'm sure it's all right if you just kill one of your own minions.
Sweet.
And at this point, you just kind of want Yogg to stop, but it's still doing relatively positive effects. Oh my goodness. Can we have, like, every fin is awesome?
Oh, new card!
Oh,
no! I want my teapots!
Oh! But he gets at least what happened there?
New card!
He light in the darkness into Arcane Giant for zero mana in Yogg Druid when the card is not yet legal in the tournament, Dan.
That's Arstone.
Oh, Yogg, good card. That is the correct reaction. Concede, let's play a different game of Hearthstone.
All right. I mean, to be fair, that was a 10-mana card, and 10 mana is the most that you can spend. And if that card was Deathwing or something along that power line, I think the mage would have been in big trouble. But all things considering, that was really, really cool.
No, down. I'm not going to let that one slide.
What?
If he'd have cast Deathwing, he would have zero cards in hand.
He only tossed two swipes.
And a solitary 12-12 on the
board. Mage had no cards in the hand either.
That is not comparable to what just happened.
Mage drew Flame Strike against the Deathwing. Yeah. It would have been just as powerful.
What if he drew Mirror Images?
He already played both.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
So it would have been a calculated risk.
All right.
I do like the fact that we saw two of those Wing 2 cards. Karakazam and the Arcane Giant.
I mean, that turn was sick. From an entertainment standpoint, yeah. I cannot dispute that turn was awesome.
People say that they're not sure if Karakazam is a very strong card, but it is another card that Yogg-Saron can generate a board for you.
Yeah.
That is something of a very legitimate concern, considering, like, a legitimate factor if you're a person that's, like, waiting for Yogg and you're hoping that they don't build too much of a board. Call of the Wild, Stand Against Darkness, Karakazam, Force of Nature. These are all cards that are very resilient, and then they buff it.
I thought you were going to say, these are all cards that he cast in that one turn. From his Yogg-Saron.
It's true. It was a full board. He drew a lot of cards, and he summoned a 0-mana 9/9.
Yeah. Pretty solid.
Pretty awesome. Yeah. I mean, a lot of people are sticking Arcane Giant into this deck,
yeah.
And somehow Pascua found a way to put it in this deck, despite the fact that we didn't enable Wing 2, because it came out the day before prelim started for America.
Yeah, for clarity, we should specify the Wing 2 cards aren't allowed to be put into your deck naturally, but if you do get them from random effects, like Discover Effects or Mulch or Yogg-Saron, as we saw there, we're not going to, like, handicap the players by saying, no, you're not allowed to play that card. Like, that card was legal to be played on the board, it just wasn't legal to be put in his deck.
Okay. That's a very good clarification. I did get word just now that apparently there's a slight mistake on the overlay. The Shaman was actually banned.
Oh.
The Warrior was actually banned from Pascua, and then I believe it is Shaman. It's correct now, and it was wrong earlier.
So his Warrior is live, his Shaman is banned for Pascua. That's what you're telling me. Okay, awesome.
Oh, and that was Pascua did bring Warrior.
Yeah, Pascua has the OTK Worgen Warrior, and it is his control Shaman that is banned.
Apologies there. The overlay is fixed. It's correct now. And thus, we will begin Warrior versus the Druid. It is, as you stated, a one-turn kill Worgen Warrior.
Yes.
He did manage to fit in that Shield Slam, which we were joking about earlier about how one player fitted in but also forgot charge.
Correct.
So what did he strip from his deck to put in a Shield Slam?
So he is playing two Loot Hoarders still. He is playing two Slams still. I don't know is my direct answer to that question. What has he cut from this deck? Oh, the Cruel Taskmaster is what he's missing.
Makes sense. Yeah. This deck is extremely powerful if it's able to get its card engine draw. Very often it draws to the last five cards or less.
Yes.
And it's very quickly, like turn 7, turn 8. Mm-hmm. Things like Battle Rage and the fact that you can also cycle through your Acolytes very aggressively, very consistently.
Yeah.
Makes this deck really strong opponent.
Yeah, and the big deal here for Topo Pablo potentially is how many taunts he is running in his Druid deck. He does have the double Ancient of War, no Druid of the Claws though, so this is going to be very much about the tug of war with the card Execute, whether Topo Power can demand an Execute on a card that isn't an Ancient of War by, you know, using Fandral or Violet Teacher to leverage the board. If that can happen, he can potentially wall the game out with Ancient of War.
Yes, that is a very good point, because you just really can't armor stack enough as a druid to get outside that range. I believe the maximum damage if they hold all of their resources of Inner Rage and Rampage is 52 without the Cruel Taskmaster.
That sounds right to me.
So 52, you're not getting out of that range even if you got two Feral Rages, and you're
right.
And that's like the one of Miguel of Raven idol. So it's like it doesn't seem very practical.
You'd have to somehow cast Yogg-Saron and cast Light in the Darkness twice and get Bran and Ancient Shieldbearer and then somehow get enough C'Thun minions to buff it and put a C'Thun in your deck.
Actually, maybe Bran and Arcanosmith.
I mean, it sounds ridiculous, but I bet Yogg could make that happen somehow.
Yogg could do anything.
Yeah, I think so.
That is why I've devoted my life towards the cause.
Interesting.
That's why I'm wearing this pink suit. Yogg told me to do it last night.
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't know Yogg was...
See, C'Thun lowers my self-esteem, but Yogg-Saron makes me believe I can do anything. That's why I serve him and him alone.
So why does Yogg in particular have such a connection to the color pink?
I don't know. It's the way the art was described. You should ask Ben Brode.
Okay.
Because he's the one who's probably the mind behind Yogg-Saron.
Makes sense. I wonder if the other gods have favorite colors as well.
They probably do. C'Thun's most likely purple. Mm. For makes sense obvious reason.
Yeah.
Yashiraj is green, I guess. Mm-hmm. And then N'Zoth is like brown. It's just depressing. I don't know. This is.
Sure.
What's your favorite color, Sottle?
My favorite color is purple, matching my shirt right now.
It's a great color choice.
It is indeed. But anyway, back in the game of Hearthstone that we're actually playing, Blood Mage Thaunos is down on the board, and this is kind of an awkward target. Pascoa might decide to just try and coin out Acolyte here for value, but Topo Pablo has probably considered that as an option, knows that he has the Living Roots to try and counteract that play if it comes out.
What now?
Yeah, Topo Pablo also had like a really long turn deciding between Power of the Wild, Living Roots, and one other relevant card off the Raven Idol, and chose Power of the Wild. And I think it's because he recognizes that he really needs board presence of some sort. Like, he can't really pass these early turns with hero power or just very weak Living Roots, which is cleared by the multitude of one damage whirlwind effects that Warrior has.
Right. So in the end, he's just going to choose to Fiery War Axe here, not take the risk with that Acolyte. And I think this is just one player giving the other player some credit here, right? It's, people understand the dynamic of Coin Acolyte of Pain in a lot of control decks, especially combo decks, cycle decks. So Pascoa is probably giving his opponent enough credit here to say he's not going to play that Blood Mage unless he has an answer to my Acolyte.
Yeah, it's a very common mistake made at the very beginning levels of Hearthstone, where players, especially in like Control Warrior versus Control Warrior in the past, people used to play Armorsmith on turn two without the ability to actually answer a turn three Acolyte of Pain, and they end up letting the opponent draw cards. And then the train of thought became of, well, I want my opponent to draw cards. So then my opponent played Acolyte and willingly drew cards. So then there's like all these different types of win conditions and dynamics, but that's what makes it pretty interesting at the high level.
And now the Acolyte of Pain coming down on the board with the Blood Mage gone means there is actually not a clean answer unless he wants to do something ridiculous like Savage Roar Hero Power to deny the card draw here.
Sure.
There's no way to deny this Acolyte starting to get value.
Right. If it's going to draw cards anyways, you might want to stick onto your plan.
Yep.
If you know your opponent's not running cool Taskmaster, the chances of the Acolyte also trading up twice or trading and drawing card twice is reduced a lot. You have to part ways with Inner Range. It is scary proposition, though. Your opponent, like, one of the scary things about the Fiery War Axe to answer the Blood Mage is also the Warriors has dipped below 30 health. Mm-hmm. Therefore, Battle Rage is also live. So if they have a Blood to Ichor and Battle Rage or Inner Rage, Battle Rage, all of a sudden, the card draw trade begins. It's not going to stop.
Yeah, so Topo Pablo looks like he has an awkward decision here, and he is going to Living Roots onto the board and just make the Power of the Wild play here. So this is kind of the other stance. As you said, Topo Pablo accepts that the Acolyte is going to draw cards anyway.
I like this a lot.
And he says, all right, that Acolyte's going to draw. There's no real way that I'm going to stop that. So I'm just going to make the biggest power play that I can make on this turn.
Not sure how well that's going to work, considering there's Ravage Ghoul and Blood to Ichor. Pretty nasty stuff.
Yeah, and the Acolyte attack as well that could go in to take out another one. So, and we're going to pick up two more cards off the Acolyte here. Second Blood to Ichor comes just a little bit too late. He can still choose to use it for removal, but it will miss out on the token generation, but still has the attack from the Acolyte and the War Axe to clear out the majority of this board.
Yeah, and Pascoa takes the damage onto his slime, which I believe he was thinking about cards like Battle Rage, perhaps in the long term. But
well, he does. It was either take damage on the slime or have no slime. There's no other way to do it, right? It was a two health minion, so he had to Ichor it first.
Correct. I thought he was gonna do it on his Acolyte. Like, he would play Ravaging Ghoul and then do it on his Acolyte.
Oh, okay, sure.
So
like that would clear one less 2/2, but I can understand the merit of like valuing one more card over a 2/2 on the board.
Because a lot of times I actually care about the card draw, like the two extra health. I mean, it does actually end up being a little bit more because sometimes you can't clear that 1/1 or 2/1. Sometimes you get Savage Roar down, but I do tend to like that one extra card if you're getting, especially because Acolyte only drew two, but you can always get more.
Yep. But the way it works out, the fact that he does have the damage on his Ica token means that he gets that card back anyway, since he now has a damage source for Battle Rage if he wants to use that this turn. Fiery War Axe number 2 comes down to cleanly take care of the 3-3, but having now used one of his Ravaging Ghouls already, that Onyxia in hand backed up by the Savage Roar is potentially game-ending just on its own.
In against most warrior decks, yes, I do. And I am very fearful of the Wild Pyromancer because that card has 5 Ravaging Ghouls built into it.
Yeah.
The moment you pair with the Commanding Shout, it does feel extremely intimidating to go against.
It's the way this game will develop, though. If Topo Pablo doesn't draw something to shy him away from that Onyxia, he's going to have no option but to all in it as soon as he can.
That's true.
And with the texture of the game right now, Pascoa actually doesn't have any answer despite his deck being full of them.
That's true. You're very much on point there. Phandral Staghelm, normally excellent card in almost any scenario. In this place, though, it's no different than a very vanilla 3-5 minion.
Yep.
Lead Paint, by the way, has defeated Timma, the Tavern Hero, 3-2. So Frank continuing his lower bracket run. I'm really happy to see that. I want to see him claim some redemption. A lot of people had a lot of choice words for his play yesterday.
Yeah.
But he's a much better player than what was represented yesterday.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. There are a number of adjectives that you could choose to describe the way that he played yesterday. None of them too positive, but he is an excellent player, and I'm glad to see him, as you said, making the redemption run. Hope he gets another chance to show his stuff on stream here.
I don't mind,
mind if I roll need.
Okay, he's playing the Loot Hoarder. I was like, I don't mind playing the Shield Block, but I guess it's another card to combine with the Wild Pyromancer to just get some Whirlwind effects. It is coming up on turn 9, and the Onyxia is something that you're concerned about, sort of.
Yeah, and like I said, Topo just has no option here. Like, the alternatives to playing Onyxia are just so miserable, but just in the nick of time, Pascoa was able to pick up that Wild Pyromancer. But the problem now, or the not the problem, but the debate for Pascoa is executing this AA, right? Like, as I said, there are 2 Ancient of Wars in this deck that can both wall you out of the game. Like, do you need to execute this AA? The answer is probably yes, especially when your opponent is so low on cards. But still, it's something that you do have to consider a lot more than you might think is immediately apparent, right?
Speak to me.
What? You have a strange look on your face, Dan.
I'm trying to think about the sequencing that Pascoa wants. And don't be shocked when we keep pointing this out, because the sequencing does matter a lot in this deck. I think he gave up his Pyromancer for free by doing this. But one thing I do like about Pascoa's ordering is that he's been very selective on how he times the coin, because the coin is something that a lot of people just willingly toss out there because they feel like, I want to use as much mana as I can. But in this case, it was very valuable for him to get the Whirlwind. He didn't have to give up the Pyromancer.
Right. So it wasn't 100% for free. He gained 2 damage to face out of it. He could have sent the Loot Hoarder into the Onyxia to trigger execute and then do it that way.
That's right.
Which I agree almost certainly is better in this situation. But it's not a strictly wrong play, but probably an incorrect decision in the long run.
Yeah, to borrow a term that Raynad was using a lot yesterday, is that I think a lot of these macro decisions from Pascoa are very on point. I think some of these small, very little micro decisions haven't been extremely impactful, but they are ways you can tidy up the play. But overall, I can't really disagree with what Pascoa is doing right now. His general philosophy has been very good, like keep the board clean, squeaky clean, draw a ton of cards, get closer to that inevitability where you have the Faces Manipulator to pair with the charging Raging Worgen that can do upwards of 26 damage on its own.
Yes, indeed. And you see another bracket update. Oh, I've waited so long to be able to say the name Noblord on stream, and I can finally do it. Noblord has defeated Terrence M 3-1. So Terrence M's run was at an end. He did just have a very unfortunate series of games on stream yesterday. Fortunately, his luck has not turned around too much. Noblord, on the other hand, though, is marching on.
It's a very good run by Terrence, and again, another good job there by Noblord. But remember, these guys in the lower bracket, they have to win twice in order to be getting one more chance to play on stream later today.
Yeah. So finally, Emperor picked up, but this draw from Pascoa has been interesting to say the least, because he's hit all the board control and cycle cards that he's needed to control the state of the game up until now, but he's still dry on combo pieces, more or less, having just picked up that charge now. There's no Worgen, there's no Faceless, he's only just hit his Emperor as well. Mm-hmm. Still hasn't hit a commanding shout to go off with a Pyromancer either, which is kind of crazy.
Yeah, it is pretty crazy. His hand's also a little bit, like, too full, so one of the situations where he didn't want a Battle Rage because you don't want to overdraw. Burning the Worgen is actually a straight-up loss. Which, by the way, if Yogg-Saron's able to catch Naturalize on himself and burn Worgen away from the Warrior...
Oh my god.
Like, don't discount the fact that Druid still has a chance here, even though we've been talking as if Warrior is incredibly favored.
Most of these are whiffs so far. The Excavated Evil in his opponent's deck is at least a concern for him drawing a dead card.
The dream is dead.
But yeah, that the discrepancy between the two Yoggs that we have seen in these first two games for each player is pretty high.
That was like four spells?
I think like five, yeah.
Five spells? Yeah. That was too soon. Topo Pablo.
I mean, what
too
was he?
Soon.
What was he gonna do that turn? Hero power pass, right? Like, what was really his options?
It's true. Yeah. It's true. He is one of those things where even if you wait to the Emperor and then you play Yogg-Saron, it's probably too late.
Yeah.
Speaking of Emperor, as one of three playable cards this turn, you're reducing charge and rampage, and I think he wants at least one more piece so that way he can have. He can have it all in that case.
Also, consider the fact that there is a random Hunter secret in play that Pascoa has no knowledge of. So if that card is Freezing Trap, that complicates the equation enormously, as does Bear Trap.
Okay, I believe that is Snake Trap, though.
It is Snake, okay. Yeah. But from Pascoa's perspective, there is another variable thrown into this game now that he has to plan around. Like, he's going to have to stick a minion at some point to test that trap before he goes all in with his Worgen turn.
Imagine if it was Snipe and the Worgen.
Snipe as well! Oh my god, yeah, you're right.
Yeah.
Some funny
scenarios, although Yogg-Saron's time has come and gone. Our very loyal and hardworking admin tried to hover over the secret, but to no avail.
Clive just said nope.
The innkeeper says there will be nothing for you to see.
It is Snake Trap. We can confirm that it is Snake Trap.
Alright, reducing three of the pieces means that he can play everything and then some, including the Rampage. And it also executing one of the big taunts. Mm-hmm. Topo Pablo is in trouble, to say the least.
Yeah, Mulch going to come down here, and hopefully Topo Pablo is able to recognize the state of this game as well, and he realizes how important it is to protect the information of that trap, because that fear equity that he has right now is one of the few things that could potentially be keeping him alive.
Yeah, however, I do believe that even if it is Freezing Trap, he is going to still win. If it's Bear Trap, he also still wins. Primarily because Freezing Trap means only one thing gets sent back, and each Worgen is 26 damage individually.
Is that the case? Interesting.
I believe so.
Does he have everything? Oh, he does have both Inner Rages as well. Oh, you're absolutely right.
So
yeah.
Each Worgen will do 13 damage just by itself. I think... Well, he's already tested for Snipe, so that's already out of the equation.
Mm-hmm. So if he Worgens, he Inner Rages twice, and he Rampages, he has enough health to survive Explosive Trap as well.
That's true.
So I think in every single world, he has lethal this turn, right?
Misdirection, perhaps.
Apart from Snipe. Snipe is the one, but he's played Emperor already, which rules that out.
There is a misdirection possibility.
There is a misdirection possibility. It hits
the other Worgen.
Oh.
Wait, so in that case, what's the best sequencing is to play Worgen.
One Worgen attack face first.
Right.
And then faceless it afterwards.
Yeah. He's running out of time, though, so he's going to have to wait for one more turn.
Right. And in his defense, he has missed lethal this turn.
Yes,
have only just found the line with full information that beats every option as the rope hit the end, right?
I don't blame
and he has concealed information to work with, so.
Yes. Completely agree. And time is, I believe, on his side because he could also just pick up the second execute as well. So even if his opponent did play another huge thing, he could just get the execute with Ravaging Ghoul.
I hope during these off turns for Pascoa, he is not thinking about anything else except these trap permutations, because they are absolutely the only things that are relevant right now.
Mm-hmm. OK.
commanding shouts. This should be it. Sequencing is correct.
Yeah. I mean, he's going to get the good news that this is Snake Trap, the one completely irrelevant secret in this scenario.
Yeah. I think that is the only one that won't do anything.
Actually,
it's
wait.
A ton of damage, though.
Even then, I mean, he has lethal here. The game is over. Pascawa is going to go to the hill. But even then, the line that we came up with that beats Misdirection loses to Freezing Trap.
Oh, you're right.
Yeah.
So there was no perfect
this
line.
Deck is hard, so right?
No, there was no perfect line.
Nope.
So you have to think about the odds of which one damages you worse.
Right.
And I think Freezing Trap is worse. Misdirection at least can hit yourself or hit the minion.
Yes.
Versus you lose your win condition altogether.
Yeah.
So you should play around Freezing. Or you should play around Freezing Trap first.
In the end, very well navigated from Pascoa, and he is now on the hill, 2-0. Just has to pick up a win with his Freeze Mage. And remember, these guys are fighting not just for a spot at the Summer Championships, they're also fighting for a South American legacy, honestly, because
it's true.
There has always been a South American representative. And these two players in a qualification match in the upper bracket are both from the South America's region, which means one of these two gets to carry on that tradition.
Yeah, and I'm really pleased to see that both these guys thought a little bit outside the box here. You saw that Pascoa did bring that control shaman, did get banned, but he's also bringing his own flavor on things. We don't really see the Worgen decks get too far. I think a lot of players have gotten disenchanted with it. Like, they were originally very happy to see it. Right. Everyone already very prepared to declare the new Patron Warrior deck that we saw prominent last year. Not really the case. It kind of fell off because they realized that its matchups across the board were very weak. But one of the things that Pascoa has been able to do is you can't really argue with the results. He's gotten this far with it.
Yeah, I mean, this is I heard TJ talking yesterday about lineups that were theorized to be favored against the core lineup that the average player would bring, the Dragon Warrior, Zoo, Shaman, etc. lineup. And these kind of decks are decks that make that kind of thing up. Other people were bringing in Rogue as well to play that kind of role. But these kind of combo, kind of non-interactive solitaire style decks that Pascoa is favoring tend to do pretty well against decks that just kind of want to develop a lot of stats onto the board.
I do somewhat resent that. I do feel like as Standard gets more mature and established, I feel like decks such as Freeze Mage do have a lot of turns of interaction where it requires a lot of thought.
Damn.
I do believe that.
You don't have to defend Freeze Mage to me, okay?
Okay.
I mean,
I'm just putting it out there because I do feel like there's a lot of propaganda put out there by fluffy Pomeranian dogs.
I was going to say.
Very handsome men in their mid-30s.
If you need a handy tooltip to tell the difference between me and Kibler is the enthusiastic, good-looking one.
Okay.
So it's fine. You don't have to defend Freeze Mage.
You're the cold-hearted, iron-forged Brit who's had Yogg-Saron play one too many times against you.
Exactly.
Fair enough.
Right.
But I do feel like Freeze Mage is constantly evolving with the meta too, and there's a lot of things specifically that makes me respect the deck more. And it's very hard because as you learn a deck more in depth, you tend to actually respect it less because you start simplifying down its
sure.
conditions
yeah,
much easier.
I think that's
easier.
True. Yeah.
But I do feel like the more you understand a deck like Freeze Mage, the more you understand a deck like the old Patron Warrior, the less you actually realize you knew about it, and then the more paths and diversity it opens up. And actually, look no further than this matchup specifically, Freeze Mage versus the Token Druid, which many believe for a little bit of time in Standard that the Druid was favored due to the fact that it could put on good board pressure, it had Feral Rage to get outside of range of burn. However, Freeze Mages once again have adapted to that plan, and Druids have been trying to stop it.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, this is one of extremely interesting matchup, very, very swingy. It kind of comes down to just repeatedly having answers, and the one turn where you don't have an answer, and then suddenly Savage Roar or Soul of the Forest or some combination of those things happens, then that's when you really, really, really get punished. But yeah, I mean, I personally am a big fan of Freeze Mage. I like to see it, but the original comment was just referring to it frustrates people who are trying to play for stats on the board, right? Which is, that's kind of its role in the game to do that kind of thing. So when a lot of the power decks in the format do just play for stats on the board, then it makes sense to be playing Freeze Mage.
Yeah, I do understand that a lot of players do feel frustrated that they feel like this turn doesn't matter because next they can't kill them anyways with the ice block. However, we will see more players learn how to play better against Freeze Mage. Freeze Mage will adapt. So for example, in this matchup, a lot of Freeze Mage players have trouble identifying what Laughing coins as, quote, the turn.
Mm.
And the turn in a Freeze Mage matchup is primarily defined against a deck that's trying to put on pressure through the board. And you have to learn when to let go of board control as Freeze Mage and then try to kill your opponent. Yep. And many players have a very difficult time identifying it because they're either extremely conservative and they die too fast,
yeah,
or they overextend and they're inefficient with their removal in the sake of staying alive and they miss their chance to win.
Exactly.
And a lot of players really misidentify it because they can't really... They're not counting properly with their burn. They're not adjusting for their mana cost. They're not calculating what's the chances their opponent has of specific cards.
Yeah, and so there's kind of another level to that. Most people who've played at least a few games of Freeze Mage can identify the situations where, okay, I don't have to care about your board anymore because next turn I freeze your board, the turn after that I Alex you, the turn after that I kill you.
Right.
Where the difficult part comes in is where you don't necessarily have all those options compiled in your hand already, but the chance that you draw the cards you need over the next couple of turns is more likely than you winning the game by continuing to try and answer your opponent's board.
Right. And so now, actually about this game, which five turns into it, we haven't actually talked about any of the turn plays.
We've talked a lot about Freeze Mage, though.
We have talked a lot. Druid does have Feral Rage in the hand, so that does help a lot, but mm-hmm. I feel like when you're in a position where you have to use Feral Rage, you're already in an awkward spot.
Agreed.
So is this a turn you set up a secret? Is it a turn you remove, or do you want to draw?
I mean, the hand has plenty of cycle in it, and these cycle cards are all kind of units of mana that need to be spent over the course of the game to just pull them out of your hand and replace them with better cards. So I'm a big fan of at least cycling something this turn. Okay. He doesn't have to respect the 1-1 too much, especially since he's just generated an ice barrier. So I'm okay with this decision. I'm not entirely sure why we play Blood Mage over a Novice Engineer, though.
Yeah, the thought of Death Rattle draws is primarily because the draw is not guaranteed immediately when you play
right.
the minion. However, Blood Mage is one of the more valuable ones yeah. compared to Loot Hoarders, considering the burn damage, or just spell damage that you get. And it's not even necessarily to kill your opponent, it's the fact that things like Forgotten Torch and Frostbolt do a little bit more, or even Blizzard, that's very useful. And you already have two Novice Engineers, so I feel like diversity of your hand is also really important mm-hmm. as Freeze Mage, so that way you're not stuck with removing Fireball and Azure Drake, for example. Mm. You might be able to pick up that Forgotten Torch if it's that one card draw away. So that is something to evaluate, but I don't necessarily hate it. I like that he played that instead of, you know, playing like Acolyte and Pink, for example.
Sure. Yeah, I
or
think
playing Fireball.
Novice Engineer is definitely the best form of cycle that you can have in the late game because, like you said, it's a quick cycle that can immediately pick you up an answer. But with two novices in hand and with Blood Mage being a valuable tool for AoE purposes, honestly, as well in this matchup, it's quite easy for Druid to build a token board to three if they're given enough time, at which point Blood Mage Blizzard becomes an incredibly efficient answer if you need to go down that line. But
yep.
Pascoa does choose to just commit the Blood Mage, as you said, just to get the slow cycle out of his hand first. And he is drawing a decent combination of cycle in the early game. He's going to try and get a Doomsayer off here, which he probably isn't too hopeful of, but it will at least gain him an additional 7 life.
Yeah, and again, it's even more depending on how things go. It also disrupts his opponent's turn if you wanted to play Ancient of War. Which is also really important. One of the things that Doomsayer does best is not necessarily just the fact that you might threaten to clear the board. That is the primary reason why it's amazing. The very strong secondary reason is that it disrupts your opponent's turn heavily.
Mm-hmm.
So if your opponent, for example, if they're playing other combo decks in the mirror, for example, you disrupt their Emperor or Alexstrasza turns. In this case, he can't play Ancient War.
So he's going to give up his coin here, it looks like, just to be able to spend the mana on casting a Raven Idol this turn, because I'm sure Coin Wrath is going to be the follow-up that we see to this. Power of the Wild is not quite enough to get the job done on the board.
What about Healing Touch? I don't hate that pick.
He has 16 points of healing, 8 points of which cannot be interacted with by Alexstrasza in his hand, so that is kind of a big deal.
Yeah, and that's something that I don't believe Pascoa will be accounting for.
No.
That's something that you think about maybe one Feral Rage, but the Healing Touch is a lot. Alexstrasza comes in the hand, though.
Yeah, Pascoa nods as if, all right, nice, we got Alex, like we have a game plan now, but little does he know, Topo Pablo's hand interacts pretty well with the Alex you in the face on turn 9 game plan.
It does. However, one of the things to consider is that eventually Pasco will go on the offensive anyways, and Topo Pablo still has to figure out a way to be aggressive right back. He's got very defensive cards. It's the same as the Murloc Paladin, which can heal for a while, but you know, eventually the freeze mage. Well, and that's a very different case. That's actually a bad analogy. The better analogy is like the fact that like priest can also heal like after the Alexstrasza, but it doesn't actually kill the freeze mage. So the freeze mage can actually recover even if it's starting to heal a little bit.
Right. But this deck still has plenty of aggression packed in it. I mean, as well as all the healing, he has a swipe and a Savage Roar already in his hand. And if he's comfortable, he has Feral Rage that can be used offensively as well. So it's not like he's shy on damage. He just has that extra security of the two healing cards already. He is just going to go ahead and be aggressive here. He is going to limit the potential of another ping on the Acolyte here, valuing one card over two damage of his own, which I think makes sense based on, again, the texture of his hand. He's able to go a little bit longer in this game due to the amount of healing that he has, so he doesn't have to rush the opponent down immediately. As you said, though, does need to keep make sure he's paying attention to being aggressive where he can.
Man, this is actually a really tricky turn. This is the turn you want to play Ice Block to set up for Alexstrasza. I guess in that case, you can play just Frost Nova and Doomsayer. Is your hand good enough post Alexstrasza, though?
No, I don't think it is. I think that's the problem. The turn 9 Alex plan just isn't going to work here most of the time. You're going to sacrifice too much board. You're going to sacrifice probably at least one Ice Block to getting that process done, and you don't really have significant gains from it on turn 10. So I think we need to find an alternate plan here involving cycling our deck just a little bit more, and he's going to try and get the Frost Nova Doomsayer to go off here as well.
Yeah, it doesn't have a direct way to kill the Emperor Thor, saying would have to dig a little bit deeper. And, you know, interestingly enough, Topo Pablo doesn't have a very clean way to kill it. You definitely don't want to use Feral Reach if you don't have to, and then swipe and, what, Savage Roar in order to clear out the Doomsayer?
Swipe.
That's awkward.
Swipe Savage Roar does get the job done, and those are the two cards that Topo just moused over in his hand, but that is so much endgame damage that you are giving up to do that. Like, how much do you value this board right now? Right? How, like, first equation, how much damage on average is Savage Roar worth in this matchup? Plus the damage from swipe. And then weigh that against what does this board do for me if I hold on to it? And that's not just in terms of how much damage will these minions hit for, it's how much does me still having these minions disrupt what my mage opponent wants to do on their following turn.
Okay. So Savage Roar, if you can get three minions with it, is 8 damage.
Yeah.
Which I think is very fair considering the Violet Teachers. And if you, well, actually he's just playing Alexstrasza, so he gets to preserve 9 of that damage, so it's an equal trade here for Topo Pablo. And now he has the opportunity to clear Alexstrasza and heal up. First gonna Wild Cycle Growth, I don't disagree with that at all.
Yep, definitely this is the first thing to happen here. He also picked up Fandral, so he can actually use Feral Rage to push 4 damage as well at the same time. That's if he good. Wants to go down that route.
Actually, I like that a lot. Innervate, how does that interact with Fandral? He has 12 mana available this turn.
He has no way to clear the Alexstrasza without taking damage himself, right?
He can put
both minions in, but then you're not really pushing damage.
What you can do is you can do Fandral, Healing Touch, and then Innervate Ancient of War for a 10-10.
Ooh.
You like that?
I like that a lot.
I mean, Emperor is great to have around, but I wouldn't mind uprooting and rooting my Ancient of War.
Yeah, let's do that. Honestly, that seems like a good line. I don't mind using the Feral Rage as well. Just while you have the Fandral, you might as well get the double value. But since you're pulling yourself up to 23, the maximum damage a Freeze Mage can do under non-Emperor Thorasan conditions is 21. And that involves Blood Mage Thaunos that you've already seen. So you know you're safe here at 24.
It's a very good observation. I was trying to think about like ways Pasco can remove the Fandral, because Fandral is also very threatening too, not just Emperor. There's just so many things that demand attention from the Druid deck that's so problematic to remove.
Yeah,
Pasco has got no answer to it.
He does have two Ice Lances in hand now, where his is his burn only, and he's if he's going to try and win this game long-term now, which he does have to start thinking long-term, big-picture thinking now that the Druid has shown healing after the Alexstrasza, he's probably going to have to just go ahead and try and Ice Lance this Ancient of War. Or is he going to try and rely on the mirror images to tank it? This is ambitious.
That's ambitious, but I like it, because in this case, I like it because it works.
It's going to work, yeah.
But I also like it because, you know what? I mean, you have to really squeeze out this efficiency as much as you can, and that is...
the fist bump! It's like, yes, 0-10 taunt!
That mirror image healed for 13 health.
Yep, it's pretty
sick. That's absurd.
Yep.
Because, again, the whole point is recognizing when you can have the turn, and the turn is about tanking the damage when you can in order to go for the win condition of burning your opponent down. Pascoy already just bought himself two turns now.
Yeah,
by doing that.
Very, very possible. And now the hand is starting to come together. He picked up a Frost Nova, so that's another turn of stall, and it's a high tempo stall as well. Leaves him 7 mana available to progress through the rest of his hand as well. And he has these 2 loot hoarders to cash in for more draws here. So suddenly that mirror image turn, like I said, it was ambitious, but it may have been the turn that he needed to actually find himself a win condition in this matchup.
He still has Blizzards in the deck. The one thing that I am interested in is how he gets around the Healing Touch, because that is a ton of damage, and he did use his Blood Mage. Blizzard out this turn allows him to play Ice Block. I think the hero powers are also going to be very relevant, so I wouldn't hate for him to even play Acolyte Hero Power and then play Frost Nova.
I like Acolyte Ping. Starting the turn with Acolyte Ping is definitely the line that I like here. Pascoa did just toy with the Ice Block on the left of his hand here. He might just be considering the options of, I want to get this 3 mana spent while I have time, but yeah, I think this is a more ambitious line, a more aggressive line. I'd like to see him going down it.
Chooses to play the Ice Block instead of Freeze.
Interesting.
So he's going to be willingly taking... So essentially when you do this, this is the turn that he's saying. He says, I'm feeling like I can take 18 damage plus, maybe 19 with the hero power, I guess the trade in here. And I'm okay with working with this much health. And to be fair, it's 12 is still like reasonably hard for Druid to produce from the hand if you can chain freeze the board. I mean, how do you deal with 12? Now that Swipes and Feral Rage has been used.
It's a good question. And the other thing that this line does is it opens him up to Emperor Frostnova on a following turn now, which is potentially beneficial for him. And the one way he can possibly beat Healing Touch, which of course is not a card he's aware of, but just stop stacking up so much burn so cheaply in his hand that he can just unleash it all in a single turn.
It's scenarios like this, which I always regret not putting Emperor Thoris in, Archmage Antonitis into the deck. It's a card that's been cycled out of a lot of Freeze Mages because they felt like it was luxurious. You didn't really need it. A lot of times it's clunky and you don't even play it a lot of times usefully. It's like Antonitis Ice Block, you know? How often do you get the scenarios? But imagine if he did have the opportunity, then he has that reach damage he needs. And right now, Topo Pablo, he's probably just going to mulch this down and pray that his opponent doesn't have a lot of burn, but maybe even considers using Healing Touch this turn.
Yeah, 25 is a big ask for an opponent who has... Have they put any Roaring Torches in their deck yet? I don't remember. There's one Roaring Torch in there?
Oh, no. He hasn't yet.
Okay. So, yeah, that's a very, very big ask in a no Pyroblast deck.
Okay. Wait. Never mind. Sorry. Eater of Secrets was on the wrong side.
Yeah. almost the single funniest thing that has ever happened in Hearthstone, but not quite. And yeah, Pascoa has no option here but to commit. The torches are going to go. 2 Roaring Torches are now put back in the deck. And there is no option. There's no Blood Mage to wait for. As you've said, the turn has passed, so he's committed at this point. So as long as he's weaving in a ping every turn, he can just pretty much fire away everything that he needs.
Yeah. Okay, so let's count the damage. So he's got 6 from the Frostbolts, 8 from the Ice Lance, so it's 14. He's got 2 more torches in there, so that's 32 damage. And by my count, Topopal is at 20 right now with the ability to gain 8. He needs the hero power every single turn. And if Pascoa draws those 2 torches back to back and weaves in the hero powers, then Topo Pablo is toast and he has to be relying on Yogg-Saron
to save him.
A quick check from the observer as to how many cards exactly left in Pascoa's deck
I believe
would be
three.
Very helpful at this point. Three? Okay.
I believe three, because he said he's almost out of cards, or she.
Ah!
And then he puts two torches into
there
the deck.
There you go. Beautiful.
He sees the healing touch, and that is really brutal, but
he still has
turns.
It.
All he needs to do is draw
cards. There it is.
Draw the two torches in the next two turns.
It's going to be a 50-50 next turn. Right?
Well, I mean, the Yogg-Saron could also see
it. The Yogg can have something to say about it, yeah. So Roaring Torch goes through, the Ice Lances go through, the Ping is going to go through. This game is coming down right to the wire. Wait, no, he's at 11.
Oh,
he's at 11.
He hasn't played Frostbolt yet, right?
Right, but there's a Roaring Torch, a Frostbolt, and a Ping left. That's 10 damage.
What did I count right?
I don't know. I trusted you, Dan.
I trusted you. Oh, I counted it was 14, 26. Oh, I counted an extra fireball by accident.
Okay.
So actually, he is slightly outside of range.
Is the last card an actual fireball, though?
I think Ms. Pascoa miscounted too, then. What was that extra damage? I said 32.
Yeah.
It's because those 14. Oh, okay.
But the real question is, what is the last card that is not the Roaring Torch at this point? Is it another fireball? Have we seen two fireballs?
Actually, I think it's another Blizzard.
Really?
If I'm calculating correctly. I counted wrong. Pascoa is definitely in an awkward position, too, because he has to ice block Frostbolt Ping. He can't really out-heal that either.
Pascoa is shaking his head here, so he doesn't look too confident. He'll know what's remaining in his deck better than we will.
Does he play both fireballs? I think he did. Okay. He used an early fireball, and then he held one awkwardly for a while against Azure Drake. I remember that. I apologize, Sottle. But I think the person that should be the most sorry for is Pascoa right now for himself.
Oh, yeah. This was a huge game for him to win. I mean, this was a matchup that was very, very winnable. He put himself in a strong position where he would have, you know, beat any outcome except Healing Touch or second Feral Rage coming down off that Raven Idol, more or less.
Yeah, it's true.
And
Without that Healing Touch.
It was a
toast.
Hugely important game because now with this, he has to reset all the way back. If the last card is not damaged, and you were right, it is the Blizzard. The damage is not left in the deck, which means Pascoa is going to have to go back to square one with the Freeze Mage. And just that game was a marathon. And now he has to do it all over again.
Yeah, you're right.
just zoned out in the corner.
I'm calculating because, you know, I'm in that zone where I'm like,
six,
well, what,
plus three, even, plus four, plus
how
four.
How did I even arrive at the number? And I'm trying to think is because maybe I was accounting in my mind for, like, Thanos because I always count for maximum damage, but then I was also two off there. So I don't even know how I got that number. Moral of the story is don't trust Froden.
Julian, okay, making a note. Don't.
Write that down.
Don't.
Lesson number one. You said you look up to me for points of advice. That's your first piece of advice straight from the horse's mouth.
I could have done with that advice 6 months ago. It would have helped me out significantly.
Yeah, there you go. All right, so the druid is out of the way here for Topo Pablo. Still very much alive. He has the shaman and the mage remaining. Now, we do remember that it is a tempo mage, and I believe that this matchup... okay, well, this matchup actually has changed a little bit in recent times. I do know that the Freeze Mages actually like this matchup a lot, and I know the Tempo Mages actually like it a lot, so it's interesting.
It's funny how that works.
Yeah. It's always funny because I think the Tempo Mages love the fact that they can put pressure from anywhere from the get-go, and it's always really awkward. But then the Freeze Mage thinks that if they... It's the same philosophy. If you always just kill minions, then how do they actually kill you?
Oh, doubly so when you're playing Freeze Mage. It's absolutely core. Like, just use any and all burn in your hand just to make sure that they don't get early initiative on the board. You know, Frostbolts and Forgotten Torches, just snipe down those 1-drops, 2-drops, and 3-drops, and just go from there.
Yeah. That being said, Temple Mage is one of the best at just killing a Doomsayer straight up on turn 5. It's like, oh, you turn 5, Frost Node Doomsayer, I just like fireball and kill your Doomsayer. So it's a little problematic to be able to land those early board clears. So I will leave it up to how these players feel themselves. And the last remaining deck from Topo Pablo, I believe, is the Aggro
Shaman. Yeah.
And that has the Maelstrom Portal as the interesting tech card, which
spicy.
I don't think it does anything.
No. Maybe if he can hit Spell Damage Totem and clear out Mirror Images to help push through, you know, if there's like Mirror Images against your 7-7, like really niche outcomes, I can see it working. Definitely not the matchup it's intended for, though.
Yeah, precisely. So the Aggressive Shaman, I have to imagine, is probably one of the decks that is the most favored here. I'm just still kind of split on the Tempo Mage, but I do know the mages in general. They tend to favor their own decks. Really cool, by the way, that I feel like Pascoa... I feel like Pascoa definitely miscounted something, too, towards the end of that game, because he looked like he was shaking his head like as if he miscounted something as well. Usually that's the head of, like, regret, like, oh, crap, I messed up. But in hindsight, is it the Blood Mage turn, you think, that really cost him?
It looks that way, right? I mean, we talked about it early on, and it looked like... It's very easy to look at a game like that and just blame it on the Raven Idol, right? It's like, oh, he had Feral Rage, and he got Healing Touch off Raven Idol. How do I beat that? But... I mean, you are only, based on the torches that you put in your deck, you're only, what, like 2 or 3 damage off at the end? And there was a turn where you cast 4 or 5 spells in one turn, and you chose to cycle a Blood Mage instead of a Novice. And you probably would have got there, right?
Yeah. I do also think that diversity of hands is really important, especially for a control deck like Freeze Mage. Mm-hmm. That's really oriented on like having the right option at the right time. So I do think that was one trivial point. Also, the fact that I do want to put to Topolpablo's credit, too, is that he was very astutely trying to weave in his Druid hero powers every single turn possible, and that ended up being the difference maker, that for 2-3 turns straight, he was able to get a little bit ahead, and Mage was not hero powering the face aggressively, and that also costed him, too, because I believe he'd just be 2 damage off the rest of the game.
Yeah, absolutely. The players did just take a very quick break. No surprise after how much of a marathon that previous game is and the stakes that are on the line here. Again, these players are fighting to be the 3rd recurring South American representative at a seasonal championship. Topolpablo has the fight back, but he does have the strong matchup here with the aggro shaman against the freeze mage.
Yeah, the aggressive shaman tends to be favored in this matchup. However, you know, talking to a couple of Freeze Mage players, they feel like this matchup's actually very even as long as you push really, really hard for Doomsayer early on. And the chances of hitting Doomsayer are actually close to 50% if you mulligan everything. Look at that! Even Loot Order doesn't make the cut because he says, I need Doomsayer, and I need Doomsayer now. This already screams to me that Pascoa is a very proficient Freeze Mage player, if it wasn't already clear.
Yeah, there was a game in, I think, America's Championship last season where a player committed, like, Lightning Bolt, Rock Biter, all on a one drop early on to kill a Doomsayer. Yeah. And people were like incredibly critical of that. But honestly, like if Doomsayer goes off on turn 2 in this matchup, your win percentage is incredibly low. So those are sometimes the kind of committals that you have to make in terms of dealing with a Doomsayer. And as we saw, the aggressive mulligan from Pascoa has paid off to an extent. He got the Doomsayer, but he would also like to have some of those cheap cycle cards that he threw away, like Loot Hoarder, in his hand.
It's true. The very difficult position, too, is also weighing this Doomsayer and the coin. This is one of the hardest decisions that you'll ever have to make in the very beginning against this deck, because this game can end very quickly by turn 6 or 7. So you have to make a decision like this very meaningful.
Oh,
and that is the punish.
That's brutal.
That is the exact punish that is best.
I actually don't think the decision was too hard. I think Pascoa has come out with the correct decision. Like coin Doomsayer just doesn't get him anywhere. It's basically 2 mana kill an Argent Squire because his turn next turn is dead anyway. So the tempo advantage of Doomsayer is completely irrelevant. So I think the decision to hold it is actually correct. It would have been fine right up until that Flame Tongue Totem got drawn.
Well, now he's going to have to put his faith in it, and...
Ooh, I like this. Ooh. I like this a lot. This is incredible recognition from Pascoa, actually. I had not looked at this option at the time, but yeah, he is banking on this Doomsayer. And as I said at the start of the matchup, you will see players on both sides doing extreme things to either ensure or prevent that Doomsayer going off.
That might actually have won in the game.
I think it might have done, yeah.
I mean, it's still too early to say. There's a lot that could happen. Oh, Ice Bear is a great pickup for Pascoa. And Arcane Select, having him a turn to play too, making sure that he doesn't have just an empty hand is really crucial.
Yeah, that Arcane Intellect has made all the difference now. His hand is looking a lot more promising. He's got more cycle. He's actually picked up some reasonable mid-game removal now with the Forgotten Torch. So he's actually progressing towards a strategy where Alexstrasza might be relevant very early in this game now.
Yeah, and if you use, you're most likely using it defensively, and a lot of times you actually burn the shaman from 30 to try to end the game. It's very rare that you get the scenario that Alexstrasza and your ice block's not like threatened immediately, and you don't have to burn. So sometimes it's okay because the shaman has a lot of these annoying small minions on board, except for obviously the Flame Wreath Faceless. And you can sometimes play Alexstrasza and not worry that your Ice Bucket gets popped because they're out of cards. Aggro Shaman still has the very difficult pop problem of refilling their hand once they lose a lot of their board.
So there's options here, and it's kind of about, you know, working backwards from where you know your turns will be. So you can choose to Forgotten Torch this turn, which looks weird in terms of mana usage. Like, if you're just going to purely base your play on mana usage this turn, then Novice Engineer Ping. It's the only thing that fits. But by using the Forgotten Torch this turn, you're then opening up, say, Novice Engineer plus Ice Block or Ice Barrier on the following turn. So mana efficiency-wise over two turns or possibly even more than that, this actually works out to be a little bit more efficient and reduces some damage on the board.
It is interesting, though, because it does feel like the hero power is not irrelevant. You get to kill off a 2-1 minion,
right?
And it's the same damage as a Feral Wolf.
But then on turn 5 at that point, your turn is play a 3-mana card because you have a million of them and you're going to have to play a 3-mana card, right? And then ping what is the question, right? At that point, you just have a wasted ping.
So this gives yourself the guaranteed ping.
Yeah.
Topo Pablo picks up more direct damage, not exactly what he's looking for. And now we actually start chaining into Blizzard and perhaps more stall. This is also, by the way, why Ice Barrier is so huge and in a lot of ways much better to play than Ice Block early on, even though Ice Block ultimately feeds into your win condition of stalling. Mm-hmm. It just makes it so that way your opponent is not within real serious range of killing you. Unless, of course, Topo Pablo picks up Doomhammer.
Feral Spirits is a pretty useful pickup. He was running out of board initiative here and at the same time didn't quite have together the damage in hand to just start purely going face. So his ability to generate onto the board is actually quite important here, but he's going to choose to hold onto it, which is interesting considering that his board can quite easily be picked apart here.
Ooh, but we got news that Muzzy has defeated Shoot, which means Muzzy is going to the lower bracket qualification round on stream. And he is, again, the point leader. He's had a lot of friends who's been rooting for him because he's been doing so well through online cups and ladder, but has never had a real chance to shine in tournaments. And we'll talk more about him, too. He's not playing in this end. Oh, my goodness. Wait, is that it? Mm-hmm. That's lethal, I believe.
Is this so? Hang on. Hang on. Is this why he didn't play Feral Spirits on the previous turn?
I think so, actually.
I mean,
that's kind of brilliant.
Wow.
Actually, yeah. He actually played directly into his outs. And Top Pablo fist pumps because he knows what was going to happen if the game dragged on too long. There's a very real chance that the Freeze Mage was going to win this game.
I'm flabbergasted. That was a game decided by two very insightful plays. The first one being the Ice Lance that we saw that we said could potentially end up winning the game. And then the second one, I guess the value of the Feral Spirits on a board where you're starting to expect your board to get frozen persistently turn after turn after turn just wasn't relevant. And Topo Pablo just looked at his hand and went, you know what? I'm just going to draw Doomhammer next turn, which is a derisive way of putting it, but when that is your out, then yeah, absolutely play towards it, right?
His hand is definitely not minion-driven. Like, he doesn't have the Flame Wreath Faces or Thing from Below, and these are like the real threatening cards that you can generate to piece that damage. So if you're looking at your hand, you have two Rock Biters and a Lightning Bolt. I don't think it's like out of this world to start considering, like, I have to play into the fact that I might draw Doomhammer and I need that to win. Plus, if my opponent doesn't do anything, then I'm going to be good. And you can't really blame Pascoa for not feeling for feeling safe at 22.
No.
He's felt very safe. He's like, there's 4 power on the board. Mm-hmm. He would specifically, for 8 mana, have to have those exact 4 cards.
Yeah.
Like, we're not exaggerating. Those exact 4 cards was the only way he could lose. And that's exactly what Topo Pablo has. So I really respect both of the plays here.
Yeah, absolutely. I think Pasco played that game. So laughing has created a culture where it's very dangerous to someone that say someone played a Freeze Mage game perfectly or even very well. But he played that game acceptably well to the point where I definitely don't criticize too many of his plays. I think
acceptably well.
Yeah, I mean, you have to hedge your bets
You're
when
so
laughing's
European,
around, right?
Man.
But I really liked his usage of his pings in the mid game and how he broke up his cards to make sure that he curved out well through turns 4, 5, 6. And I love the bravery of not playing Ice Block on the turn where he didn't play Ice Block. I think that is a high percentage play, which most of the time puts him in a strong position. But it worked out just not be good enough. But speaking of things that are good enough, Doomsayer again against an aggressive board focused early game deck.
I'm kind of feeling Topo Pablo right now. If you just look at him, when you get that kind of out specifically, that runner card that you need to be able to slam your opponent for exact mana and one over lethal, you kind of get that shot of adrenaline.
I mean, one out of these three missiles needs to hit.
It's a pretty high chance.
I'm not sure why we're committing to the Forgotten Torch first. There is literally zero reason to do this, right? Okay, not zero, because you guarantee the damage to face. You can potentially overkill by one or two, but the risk of just completely wasting a Forgotten Torch for no reason is probably more important than one or two damage, right? 1.5 damage, whatever the actual mass is.
I actually agree with you. No, not actually, but I mean, you're right, because in the optimistic scenario... Well, okay, to be fair, to hit the same target three times in that scenario is 12.5,
yep,
right?
Yep.
So it's not exactly that. Actually, no, it might be different than that because of the way the decision tree branches out, but it's pretty low. You have, let's just say, 9 out of 10 times it doesn't happen that way.
Sure.
So I think it's okay of a play, even though you're saying, you could have kept Forgotten Torch. I would have liked to see that play, though, because I think it's kind of cool.
All right. So, yeah, Mana Worm going to come out, get some extra tempo off his Arcane Intellect, generates a 2-3 on the board, and the Doomsayer kill, more importantly over the sequencing, just the texture of the game, him drawing that Arcane Missiles and being able to kill the Doomsayer is just so massive for his long-term prospects in this matchup. Because how many times have we said it just this series? Kill tempo mages things, and they cannot beat you. And Doomsayer does a pretty effective job at that kind of thing.
I think Pasco is slightly tilted here. He's playing extremely fast turns, which is a stark contrast to what he was doing before. He's starting to slow down now, which is good. I guess he's starting to compose himself, but it's kind of hard. Your Doomsayers got answered by the draw off the top of the deck, and you have to kind of calm yourself and realize that you still can win this game. Do you want to stall this turn, or do you want to draw, perhaps? I don't really like the Emperor turn. It doesn't do anything.
Yeah, the Emperor is weak. You're at 28 with an Ice Block up, so Blizzard doesn't seem too relevant. So yeah, I think, yes, perfect. I think starting the turn with Novice Engineer to cycle and just hoping to find something else to do is the best outcome here, and Loot Hoarder is definitely upper percentages of cards that you could have drawn on that turn.
Okay, Explosion. Pretty relevant, I guess. Deals with the minions, pumps up the Mana Worm. Water Elemental. Very reasonable plays here from Topo Pablo, and he's got 10 power onto the board, threatening Pasco is half of his life or more. Pasco picks up Arcane Intellect and Ice Barrier. Trying to evaluate that versus Blizzard right now.
I think I like the Arcane Intellect Ice Barrier play. If you take another round of attacks without playing Ice Barrier, there's a very real chance that Ice Barrier just becomes irrelevant in this game, so I would quite like to get the 8 life gained from it while I can.
Okay.
But Blizzard to an extent prevents a similar amount of damage, if not more, so I can see the Blizzard line, but his hand is just dwindling right now, so he needs to find time to... cast Arcane Intellect, and since that turn, Ice Barrier and Blizzard had similar effects in terms of amount of life they gained you, I would have liked to see the Arcane Intellect getting used.
Yeah, that's pretty fair. He's going to use it now. Picks up Frost Nova, very useful card. 2 torches. Oh, okay, so that sets up for that way you can hero power one of them down now. Isolate one. Freezing the face doesn't really matter, doesn't stop anything.
Nope.
And Pasco seems relatively safe, even though it's been scrappy game. When you always have to use Ice Lances in awkward spots, it always feels a little uncomfortable. But Topo Pablo is far from done. Look at that, picking up the Cabala's Tome. That's amazing.
Is it done?
It is.
Let's wait and see.
Blast off of it.
I knew it!
Oh, no.
I knew
it. No. It's because you made fun of it, Sottle.
It is, yeah. If there's one thing I've learned over time...
DJ, are you watching?
TJ giving the thumbs up from off camera. TJ is apparently converted to the school of Cabalist Tome. I'm going to take a little bit more convincing. But still, that Pyroblast, there is no doubt about it, that Pyroblast is going to have an enormous impact on this game.
Yeah, because that bypasses Ice Barrier. So then if you're a Pesco, what's the best play here? Novice Engineer, Forgotten Torch leaves you four mana. It's a little awkward.
It is. I mean, are
we Ice Barrier at that point?
Right, so question number one, are we ever spending nine mana on cards that aren't Novice Engineer? The only possible yes answer to that question is Emperor Frostnova, in my opinion. So I don't think that's the play this turn, which means we have like a break point in our decision tree. So I would already have played Novice Engineer on the board just to make sure we have enough time to react to what the draw is.
That's fair. Yeah, I don't like the Emperor Frostnova primarily because your hand that you discount doesn't accomplish too much.
Right.
Also, you leave Sorcerer's Apprentice right after they played a Cabalist Tome.
Yeah.
Which, in the very worst case scenario, they and I know this isn't exactly always the worst case, but in this specific instance, if they had more Cabalist Tomes to play more cheaper things, and then all of a sudden they played almost all their hand, they accumulated a lot of burn. And I mean, we kind of laugh, but the Cabalist Tome also picked up Arcane Intellect, so that could draw into more spells, more damage. And as Freeze Mage, you need the time.
I like specifically that the Cabalist Tome gave like the horrible outcome that you described exactly, effigy when you have mirror images on the board, and then it also just hit a Pyroblast.
it's the way it works, and I know people might laugh as if, you know, Tovo Pablo was like incredibly fortunate, but that's what the deck, that's what the card's supposed to do specifically in the deck. Because you recognize that this a lot of times, even though the Temple Mage tends to be aggressive, there's a lot of instances where it tries to play into the late game. Sometimes you see Temple Mages play nothing the first three turns despite having Mana Worm, and they just hero power a lot because they recognize that they need to have swing turns, which are much more important than just getting onto the board early. You don't like that attack?
The head tilt is my standard. I'm not sure if I like that stance. Okay. I'm just trying to work out, did he have auto through never attacking again? I think the answer to that is no. So yeah, the attack is probably fine.
Okay. And I guess on Pasco aside, he's happy that it got some value.
Right. Because the Fireball without attacking would have gotten him into the range where Pyroblast could have potentially just popped bypassing the barrier, but then he would still have to have enough burn after that to do it again if there's a second ice block. So yeah, the attack is fine. I think long term, there's no reason to be too cute in this situation. You've kind of got everything you need at this point, so just playing the solid conservative lines will probably end up being game winning.
Now, I do want to say that if Tobo Pablo, let's say he, oh man, all right, forget that for a second. Ignore that card on the far right while I explain this. If Tobo Pablo chooses to Pyroblast face aggressively here, loses his board, and Pascoa gets an Alexstrasza off the top, then all of a sudden we have ourselves a game where it's like, you know, Tobo Pablo extended really far and got punished for it. And also the ping on the Mana Worm doesn't exactly make him the most confident either, because he could spend his burn to kill off this Doomsayer, but then that's effectively gaining health anyways. And if his opponent has some stall, then it ends up becoming the case where his board doesn't do anything, and then he's stuck with just Pyroblast, and again, if one rips Alexstrasza, he can be back in the same seat.
The effigy is interesting because I think because of the ordering, if there's an AoE, then it's the mirror image that gets effigy. So I think the secret here is just kind of a potential fear play, because this is a turn where you would play a counter spell that you were given off Cabalist Tome 100%, right?
Right.
So I think he's just trying to put that fear into his opponent's mind.
That's true. In that case, he might Roaring Torch first. Or even Ice Lance first, to bait it out. Roaring Torch is much more valuable than the Ice Lance. Although, you could Frost Nova Ice Lance as well. The Frost Nova is really important, though.
The Frost Nova is huge, yeah.
It's important in the sense that it's important to play it second because you play around the counterspell, like you mentioned.
Yeah. But yeah, Pasco is just going to evaluate his options here. I'm sure all of this stuff is exactly what he's thinking about. He just decides that he does not believe that that is Counterspell and just throws out the Frost Nova in the end, and he does get rewarded for that decision.
Can you really win most of the time if it's Counterspell
Probably
anyways?
Probably not, no.
You're just using two cards anyways.
Right.
The Pyroblast is going to make him not happy at all. And now we're at a breaking point. Even if he picks up the Blizzard, his Ice Claw is going to get popped.
Yeah.
Okay, can we do the burn plan?
I mean, it seems unlikely. What are we doing? Arcane Intellect into Ice Block plus something next turn? What even is that something to try and get this job done? I don't even see it.
Yeah, I mean, Pascoe doesn't look like he sees it either. He's trying to calculate because his Ice Block's going to get popped. He doesn't have enough turns. And I think he's out of time because Pavel's about to pop the Ice Block and be able to deal with the Emperor Thor's Hand accordingly. You can see the excitement in his eyes as he is already counting down the days that he can meet us for the championship for the Americas region.
Whoa, Miss Lethal, yog into Flare. What are you doing?
You are such a troll. Pascoe on his last turn, he needs another Ice Block. He needs some kind of miracle draw. And that's going to do it. Tapu Pablo is going to the America's Championship, representing Latin America for the third season in a row.
Yeah, a huge achievement for the Latin American region in general. You know, not as packed a region in terms of player quantity as we see from the North American equivalent. So the fact they've managed to get one representative through this huge, sprawling double elimination bracket every single season so far just goes to speak to the strength of some of their players.
And it also completes a reverse sweep. His opponent was up 2-0, and the pressure is really on because you have to 3-0 a Freeze Mage deck, which is known to be very consistent, and it's hard to do. But if there's, you know, if there's this is Conquest, this is a deck that you have to win with every single deck, and Freeze Mage does have its weaknesses to certain things that are very popular into the metagame. Aggro Shaman, for example, shouldn't be that big of a surprise to win. So a job well done to Tablo, and we have our first player through to the top eight of the America's Championship. And I think this also should just continue to build credibility for a region that is largely underestimated.
Right. Yeah, I mean, that definitely makes a lot of sense to me. It's just a staggering achievement over and over again. And I think both of those players definitely had their moments in that series where they both, you know, it established they were thinking about the game at a very high level. So that, again, speaks to the strength of the region, that not only do they have one player's qualifying, but the players that we see on stream for them are actually performing very well.
Absolutely. So we are done with our first series. Pascoe, we get another chance in the lower bracket up against some of the opponents that we'll introduce later on. But for now, we're going to head over to TJ and the Blackboard for a quick update on what's happening.
Thank you very much, Dan. Another South American player booking their spot at a championship event. Tobo Pablo wasn't able to do an interview with us due to a language barrier, but I'm joined by That's Admirable to talk about that last match and also to give you guys an update on what's happening next. So Admirable, a reverse sweep and Tempo Mage being that last deck. What'd you think of that one?
Not only just Tempo Mage, but the variation of Tempo Mage that we're seeing with the double Kabbalist Tome to give you that extra value at the end of the game. And for me, the most important part is just seeing Topo Pablo overcome with emotion as he takes down the win and secures himself that championship spot. You could see how much it meant to him, and it's always wonderful to see players celebrate when they achieve something of that caliber,
especially in a reverse sweep as well. So that was impressive. And now, so all three seasons, Latin America has booked a spot, and we might even get two because Pascoe is going down into the lower bracket. He'll be playing on later today. Latin America, is this going to be their chance? Is Topo Pablo going to be the representative? I know I've played him on ladder quite a few times on A. He's beat me probably most of them. Is he going to be the representative that's going to do it for Latin America?
Well, the more chances you get, the better chance you are you're going to have to win. And now you said it, three seasons in a row, they've made it to that championship spot. So always hunting for it. Maybe he's the one who can take it down.
Indeed. And you can see our next match, Dude 7597 versus Monsanto. These are the roads they took, so pretty impressive roads. But we're not going to waste any more time. We're going to get right into the match. Let's send it over the desk with Frodan and Brian.